I'd like to welcome everybody here to this news conference about Jeffrey Sterling. From the outset, I want to mention you're seeing a sign that says 97,000 plus signers. That's just part of the picture. In fact, we now have more than 150,000 people who've signed the same petition through change.org and rootsaction.org. This is the beginning, by no means the end. The petition and the campaign continue. I'm Norman Solomon. I'm executive director of the Institute for Public Accuracy. We've been here in the National Press Building for, about 18 years. My colleague Sam Husseini, the communications director, who many of you have worked with, is here with us today. One of our projects is Expose Facts, which is one of the three sponsors of our news conference today. The other being rootsaction.org, which I co-founded, and Reporters Without Borders, which has been a major force in this campaign. You're going to be hearing from the U.S. Director Delphine Halgand this morning. Jeffrey Sterling is a whistleblower, and to be very clear about this, from the outset through this moment, Jeffrey has said that all of the allegations in the indictment are false. He's a whistleblower because, as all of the testimony from all sides made clear at the trial a year ago, he quite properly, through legal channels, went to the Senate Intelligence Committee staff in early 2003 to voice concerns about the CIA's botched Operation Merlin. That's one of the reasons why, while going through channels, he, shall we say, did not endear himself to the top hierarchy of the CIA. As a matter of fact, the CIA official who personally fired him at the CIA in late 2001 was a gentleman named John Brennan. At that point, number three at the agency, now, of course, not only the director of the CIA, but very, very close to President Obama. Along with going through channels across the Potomac to express concerns about the CIA's operation, Jeffrey Sterling also earned the enmity of the top of the CIA because, again, quite legally and properly, he filed first internally and then through the court system a racial discrimination lawsuit, which was historic, which got publicity, which was on the record, and which did not, as we saw again at the trial, did not endear him to the hierarchy of the CIA. Today, you're going to hear from each of the six speakers. Then we're going to do Q&A. At 10:30 or so, we'll break up the formal session, but you are certainly invited to do one-on-one interviews here in the room. At about 11 a.m., we will make our way, all the speakers will make our way out of the building to the front of the White House, to the White House gate, carrying these 150,000 signature petitions. In the interest of time, I'm not going to read the bios to you, but I am going to go ahead and briefly introduce each speaker. You have all the bios in the paperwork that you received on the way in. Our first speaker is Jesselyn Radack. She's a whistleblower who worked at the CIA, or rather worked at the DOJ. She worked at the DOJ, about 15 years ago and more. And at the Department of Justice, she handled ethics issues. And it was in that capacity that she became a whistleblower at the Justice Department. She's an attorney. She represents whistleblowers and advocates for whistleblowers. She currently heads the Whistleblower and Source Protection Program, where she's National Security and Human Rights Director at Expose Facts. Jesselyn Radack.
Hi, good morning. Thank you for joining us here today. The Obama administration has presided over the most draconian crackdown on national security and intelligence community whistleblowers in U.S. history. the Justice Department has used the antiquated Espionage Act as a bludgeon to threaten, intimidate, silence, and imprison whistleblowers for allegedly mishandling classified information. Meanwhile, powerful, politically connected individuals accused of the same conduct receive a slap on the wrist or no punishment at all. Some even run for president of the United States. Using the Espionage Act against a whistleblower is grossly unfair. Courts have held that the government does not have to prove any harm to national security and does not have to prove any bad motive on the whistleblower's part. Classification rules mean that large parts of the trial, including Jeffrey Sterling's, are conducted in secret, shielded from media and public scrutiny. Sterling's conviction is a gross miscarriage of justice. The Espionage Act case against Sterling was the first and so far the only case handed over to a jury, and the unjust result epitomizes the wrongheadedness of using the Espionage Act against whistleblowers. He was convicted on the flimsiest of circumstantial evidence before a nearly all-white jury and pro-government judge in the most conservative court in the entire country. Jeffrey Sterling is a whistleblower. Sterling is a whistleblower because in 2003, he met with staff from the Senate Intelligence Committee to raise concerns about a botched nuclear operation called Merlin, in which we accidentally gave actionable nuclear design information to Iran. Sterling's case is reminiscent of that of my NSA whistleblower clients, Thomas Drake, Bill Binney, Kirk Wiebe, Ed Loomis, and Diane Rourke. They also used internal government channels, including, again, the Senate Intelligence Committee, to report misconduct, and they became targets of a federal criminal leak investigation for a news story by Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter and presidential pariah Jim Risen, the same reporter at issue in Jeffrey's case. And they had nothing to do with that story, just like Jeffrey had nothing to do with Jim Risen's story about Merlin and the chapter in his book dealing with the same. High-level intelligence community officials always purport to and encourage support of whistleblowers, especially using internal channels. I hear that over and over with regard to my most prominent client, Edward Snowden, including, again, from numerous presidential candidates. However, these internal channels send the exact opposite message when employees making whistleblower disclosures disclose through these internal channels exactly what Jeffrey did. And then that ends up making them targets for federal criminal leak investigations and prosecutions. The Senate Intelligence Committee has a lot to answer for repeatedly failing to protect its witnesses and selling them down the river. An investigative journalist of Jim Risen's caliber no doubt had numerous sources for his article on Merlin, but no actual sources or even suspected sources were subjected to the brutal criminal investigation that Sterling was, the whistleblower who brought his concerns through the, quote, proper internal channels. Punishing whistleblowers is a backdoor way of squelching the free press. The Justice Department used subpoenaing a reporter, Jim Risen, to dangle a sword of Damocles over Sterling's head for years and argued vociferously against any sort of legally protected reporter source privilege. In these attacks on the press, the two often forgotten victims are the whistleblowers like Jeffrey Sterling. The war on whistleblowers is a backdoor war on journalists and a de facto creation of an official secrets act, which we've managed to live for 200 years without in this country. This cannot continue. President Barack Obama should immediately pardon Jeffrey Sterling. Thank you.
Our next speaker, the CIA whistleblower, John Kiriakou, spent 23 months in prison. He was a CIA analyst and officer, former case officer, former senior investigator for the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. And as the New York Times has noted, including in its editorial capacity, John Kiriakou is the only American to go to prison in connection with the U.S. government's torture program. He went to prison for exposing it. John Kiriakou.
Thank you. Good morning. Jeffrey Sterling is a whistleblower, and we are here today because the Justice Department and the judicial system in our country have failed him. Jeffrey Sterling did exactly what he was supposed to do when blowing the whistle on a program that he believed constituted waste, fraud, abuse, and illegality, and he paid for it with his freedom. But I believe that the point wasn't just to imprison Jeffrey. Certainly the government did that. The point was to ruin him, utterly ruin him, for the rest of his life. The point was to make him unemployable. The point was to bankrupt him with legal fees far exceeding $1 million, legal fees that he'll never be able to repay. The point was to demonize him in the press. And the point was to frighten any other would-be whistleblowers. You see what we did to Jeffrey Sterling? The same thing is going to happen to you if you open your mouth and expose waste, fraud, abuse, and illegality. So it's up to us to work to help Jeffrey, to free Jeffrey, and to expose what was done with him. I want to talk very briefly about the Eastern District of Virginia, also called the Espionage Court. Jeffrey was and is a resident of St. Louis, Missouri. He did not work in the Eastern District of Virginia. He did not speak to Jim Risen in the Eastern District of Virginia. Even if he had spoken to Jim Risen lives in Maryland and works in Washington, D.C. But the Justice Department decided to charge Jeffrey in the Eastern District of Virginia because no national security defendant, whistleblower or not, ever wins in the Eastern District of Virginia. Juries in the Eastern District would convict a bologna sandwich if the government asked them to. And indeed, we see that happening all the time. So it's up to us to force the White House, through the power of our voices and the power of our signatures, 150,000 Americans believe that Jeffrey Sterling is a whistleblower and has no business being in prison. So it's up to us to go to the White House and to tell the president that we demand freedom for this innocent man, and it's time to bring him home. Thank you very much.
Our next speaker is Timothy Karr, who's a senior director of strategy for Free Press, the organization that's had a major impact in this city and around the country in terms of freedom of information, not only net neutrality and online access issues, but for free speech everywhere. Timothy Karr.
Thank you, Norman. Jesselyn just said that the war on whistleblowers is a backdoor war on journalists. And that's something that should get everyone pause, because oftentimes there is a debate between the role that journalists should actually play and advocating for themselves. It's not only that they need to advocate for themselves, but also they need to advocate for the sources and the networks that they rely upon to do their work. And in this case, we saw the New York Times and other news organizations hiring a team of lawyers to defend James Risen against the subpoena for his sources. But they didn't do much more to protest the prosecution of Jeffrey Sterling or the severe punishment that was meted out. And so Free Press is an organization that works on advocacy on these issues. And as advocates, we like to think of people in our sphere as what people, why people, and how people. What people often are people like Jeffrey Sterling or like Edward Snowden, who first alert people to a problem. The why people might be people like Glenn Greenwald or the filmmaker Laura Poitras, who actually have a history of analysis, and they explain why a problem like this is important to our society. And the how people, or organizations such as ours, such as Reporters Without Borders, such as ACLU, such as EFF, who try to figure out how to solve that problem. The problem that we're seeing in the world of journalism right now is that it's peopled with what and why people. And yet there is an aversion to this idea that they need to advocate to be how people, to actually try to solve problems. And that comes out of one of the fundamental tenets of journalism, being an objective reporter, means you're not an advocate. And so one of the things that we're advocating for is getting journalists more engaged in this case. And of course, this is a fundamental problem, not only for journalists, but for everyone who is in their sort of information ecosystem. And it's become very, very problematic in the era of the Obama administration. The Obama administration is like the Nixon administration in many respects. The Nixon administration tried to silence whistleblowers using illegal means. But the Obama administration is trying to silence whistleblowers using a misinterpretation of the laws that are on the books. And they have done it to greater impact than Nixon could ever imagine. 8 whistleblowers have been prosecuted in this administration. That's more than any presidential administration prior to Obama. And so the work of advocates needs to focus on the types of laws that this administration is using, because certainly they are setting a precedent for future administrations. The Espionage Act, which was used against Jeffrey Sterling, is an outdated law. It was written in 1917. It was designed to be used against World War I era saboteurs and communists, and has been misinterpreted by this administration with very dangerous impact on journalists and sources. There needs to be an effort to repeal the Espionage Act, to amend it, but it's not the only tool that's in the arsenal of the Obama administration. The Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, which was written in 1986, well before the internet became popularly available, has been used by this administration to prosecute people whom, for lack of a better term, we call hackers. Oftentimes there are hackers who break into systems and do things that are illegal, but there are also hackers who are doing things for social benefit. One of those, Aaron Swartz, faced U.S. prosecution under the CFAA, the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, and was hounded so severely by U.S. prosecutors in Boston that he ultimately decided, and tragically decided, to end his life. As we look at what's happened to Jeffrey Sterling, we need to look at the works that journalists need to do. Journalists need to not only advocate for themselves, which they did a very good job, the New York Times and other organizations advocating for James Risen, but they need to advocate for everyone that exists within their ecosystem of information. That includes sources, that includes whistleblowers. They also need to advocate for keeping networks open against incursions to our privacy. This administration has looked at some of the legislation that was passed in the wake of the September 11th attacks, and is considering amending some of the privacy legislation under the Patriot Act, under the FISA Amendment Act. It would also be very helpful to journalists. So really, this is, in a way, a call to arms for journalists to get more engaged with those advocates who are doing the good work defending whistleblowers, and to make this their own cause, and to join this fight and make sure that we get not only a pardon for Jeffrey Sterling, but also we change the laws that are being misinterpreted and abused to this end. Thank you.
Delphine Halgand is a longtime journalist for more than 4 years now. She's been the U.S. director, U.S. director for Reporters Without Borders. Delphine is a tireless advocate for the rights of journalists and for the rights of the public to know in a democracy. Delphine Halgand.
Thank you, Norman, and thank you for all of you for being here. Thank you for being here with Holly today to fight for Jeffrey. And I would like to thank you all for being here today on behalf of all Reporters Without Borders team who has been defending journalists, journalist sources, and freedom of information all around the world since 1985. As an organization that defends freedom of information, we are extremely concerned by the precedent set in the United States government case against Jeffrey Sterling. Jeffrey Sterling is now in jail for merely talking to a journalist. He was sentenced based only on circumstantial evidence. The evidence that formed the basis of his conviction consisted only on multiple emails and telephone conversation between the two men, between Jeffrey Sterling and James Risen. No content directly prove Jeffrey Sterling was a source. The content of most of the email and phone conversation remains unknown. Only the metadata have been made public. Here is Reporters Without Borders' main concern. The Department of Justice of the United States built a case against Jeffrey Sterling based entirely on circumstantial evidence and obtained his conviction in what the BBC called a trial by metadata. How is it possible that proving the mere existence of contact between a former CIA operative and a reporter is sufficient to convict someone of espionage? Is a relationship with a reporter the new catalyst for government prosecution of whistleblower, whether alleged or actual? If anybody can be sentenced in the United States just because he was merely talking to a journalist, where is the press freedom going in the country of the First Amendment? Prosecution of whistleblowers have a direct chilling impact on government representatives. We're not even afraid to just talk to a journalist or to appear in an email exchange or to talk just about basic information, not even confidential information. The Obama administration has prosecuted a total of 8 whistleblowers under the Espionage Act, which is more than any previous administration combined. President Barack Obama's war on whistleblowers played an important role in the decline of the United States in Reporters Without Borders Press Freedom Index. The United States now ranks at the 49th position out of 180 countries, a 14 places drop since 2012. Reporters Without Borders stands with Jeffrey Sterling and supports him in his effort to appeal his conviction. We stand with Holly, but we stand with 150,000 people who signed Holly's petition on change.org and on Roots Action to request a presidential pardon. I would like to thank these 150,000 people who are standing for a free press, who are standing for better protection of journalist sources, but who are standing for Jeffrey. Thank you to them.
Holly Sterling is a social worker, a longtime social worker in the St. Louis area, and for about 10 years now has been married to Jeffrey Sterling. So now we're going to hear from Holly Sterling.
Good morning, everyone. For those of you that came and joined us in October, welcome back. And for those of you that are here today for the first time, Jeffrey and I appreciate your interest and support today. Most of you know that in October of 2015, I wrote a letter to President Obama, a 14-page letter to President Obama, depicting what has happened to my husband and actually describing the true man that Jeffrey Sterling is, and not who that the prosecution had described him as, a former disgruntled CIA employer. I wanted to get his attention, to let him know that what he had done was a grave injustice and that he needed to correct his mistake. To date, we have not received any confirmation that he has even looked at the letter, let alone read it. So, President Obama, I am urging you, if you are watching this or any of your associates are watching today, I urge you to pick up that letter and spend 10 minutes of your time reading about what you have done to my husband and that it is wrong and you have the power and you need to do what is right. So today I am here to speak about all of the wonderful support that we have had in fighting this battle and this plight. I am honored to be here amongst all of these individuals. It is sad to say that the reason I have met them is because Jeffrey's incarcerated, but I am grateful for their friendship. And actually, we are now part of a very unfortunate but exclusive group. I would like to also say that even though today we have 150,000 signatures and rising, the petition is going to stay up indefinitely on change.org and rootsaction.org. So if you have not signed or you know people that have not signed and would take an interest in this, I urge you to email them, tweet them, and let them know that we are still fighting for justice for Jeffrey. I would like to take a little bit of time to kind of just give you an update about Jeffrey and I. He went to prison on June 16th of 2015. He is placed in Colorado, which is 900 miles from our home. As John had said, this has devastated us financially, as this has gone on for over a decade. So, of course, when we found out that's where he was going to be placed, we figured that it was another aim to basically stick it to Jeffrey and also to keep us apart. But graciously, my sister-in-law, Lori, who's here with me today, took it upon herself to make a GoFundMe site. And because of that, Jeffrey and I have had the financial support to be able for me to go visit him monthly since he has been incarcerated. And that is a gift that means the world to us. And I cannot thank everyone that has supported. If it's 50 cents or whatever, I want you to know that we are eternally grateful. Also, our home was on the brink of foreclosure, and those donations allowed us to get back and modify our loan, and I am no longer in fear of losing our home. Our 11-year-old car broke down, the transmission went out, and again, by the donations, I was able to buy a gently used vehicle to get back and forth to work. Jeffrey is doing the best he can. He's in prison, and he doesn't belong there. He's an extremely intelligent, educated man. President Obama took a person that was a productive member of our society, that was formerly a licensed lawyer in the state of New York as well, if you did not know that. And now he is making 26 cents a day tutoring convicts. Unfortunately, individuals that don't really want to learn, or they have not been educated enough to even read and write enough to be able to take a GED exam. He is routinely subjected to counts. Although I am able to visit him, he is subjected to a full body frisk, if you will, strip search. Thank you, John. before and after our visits, all of our telephone calls are monitored, all of our emails. I am grateful that I am able to speak to my husband and email him. That being said, though, it is more expensive to have my husband in prison than it was to have him at home not working for 5 years after he was arrested on January 6, 2011, and was unable to obtain employment. For those of you that don't know, I send money to Jeffrey monthly. If he would just like the luxury of salt and pepper or spices on his food, he has to buy that. So I make sure that he has whatever he wants or needs, and I will go without, because he cannot exist in that world with a simple luxury of having a candy bar. So I just continue every day to go forward and support Jeffrey, and know that with all of the help and support here today, justice at some point is going to be served. The truth has to come out. People know, 150 plus counting people know, who've never met my husband, who never will meet my husband, know that this was wrong, that he did not do anything, and that he is innocent, and he has always been innocent. Did he talk to James Risen? Yes. James Risen was a person, and the only person, that actually wrote an article about Jeffrey's discrimination case. That has never, ever not been disclosed. They did talk about that. Did Jeffrey disclose confidential information? Absolutely not. Did Jeffrey go and speak to the appropriate channels because he was in fear of our country and what would happen? Absolutely. Those things are true. Is he a whistleblower? Yes, he is. Just as John is, just as Jesselyn. But these people, you want these people working for our United States government, because they have the heart, they have the conviction, and they care about all of us, and they put their lives on the line, and their families are destroyed for helping us and for protecting us. Right now, even though with the petition, Jeffrey and I are in the midst of the appeal, I cannot discuss anything further that other than that, and we are hoping that with the pardon that he is released out of prison, but also that the appeal will be successful and ultimately vindicate him. I have, lastly, a message from Jeffrey that he wanted to have me share with everyone here today. Every day, I ask why I am forcibly separated from my wife, Holly, our family and friends. Why am I in prison? I know the answer, because it was born out of who I am today and who I have always been. The answer to my daily question is because through the years, I said no to discrimination at the CIA. I said no to government intimidation and retaliation. I said no to compromising my principles by pleading to a crime I did not commit. All the while, I was saying yes to doing the right thing, not only for myself, but also for my country. I took a stand and followed the rules. For this, I was targeted and summarily finished. Throughout, I have thought I stood alone. I have learned differently. While I have been invisible to many, many more here in this country and throughout the world have expressed solidarity with me and the cause of justice or the struggles I have endured. Their undying support and encouragement, along with that of my incredible wife, Holly, inspires me to continue fighting. Thank you all. And I thank you all for being here.
Cornel West is professor of philosophy and Christian practice at the Union Theological Seminary, also professor emeritus at Princeton University, an activist, longtime activist, author of more than 20 books, including Race Matters, Democracy Matters, Black Prophetic Fire, Radical King. And now we're going to hear from Cornel West.
I am blessed to stand here in deep solidarity with my dear brother Jeffrey Sterling. and to stand alongside my dear sister Holly and all of you lovers of justice. I have a deep love for my dear brother, and any time you love people, you hate the fact they're being treated unjustly, and you loathe the fact they've been treated unfairly. And if you don't bear public witness, the rocks are gonna shout out. But any time an innocent person is incarcerated, I don't care what color, culture, civilization, or sexual orientation, there must be some response. I think the great W.B. Du Bois, one of the greatest public intellectuals in the history of this nation, unfairly handcuffed, brought before the courts at the age of 83 years old, living in implicit house arrest in 31 Court Street in Brooklyn Heights, in the greatest borough in the world, Brooklyn. Actually bought that house from Arthur Miller, one of the finest artists, who also had to deal with government intimidation under HUAC. And Du Bois said there's four questions, and it has everything to do with our dear brother Jeffrey Sterling. How shall integrity face oppression? What does honesty do in the face of deception? What does decency do in the face of insult? And how does virtue meet brute force? I submit to you this morning that my dear brother Jeffrey Sterling is a man of integrity, of honesty, of decency, and of virtue. And he's dealing with oppression and deception and insult and brute force. And he stands in the same tradition as W.B. Du Bois and a host of others in this country and in other parts around the world of being innocent and having to pay a price that he doesn't deserve owing to arbitrary power. And his case is a historic case. Never in the history of this nation has there been a black person who had the courage to fight racial discrimination against the CIA. Never in the history of this nation has there been a black man in the White House that would allow him to go to jail unjustly. Two black men. One in power, one dealing with the arbitrary uses of power of that black president. Shame on you, President Obama, to violate the rich tradition and legacy of Fannie Lou Hamer and Martin King and W.B. Du Bois and a host of others. All our dear brother Jeffrey Sterling wants is justice, to be treated fairly, for us to be able to see publicly his innocence and his ability to flower and flourish. That's why I'm here. That's why we're marching to the White House. And we shall continue until our dear brother Jeffrey Sterling is free and his reputation is, in fact, elevated for the courage that he has in bearing witness in the face of this oppression, deception, of this insult and this brute force.
Now we have time for questions. Someone is going to be first.
I'm Anya with RT America. My question is for Jesselyn. First of all, sorry that my phone went off while you were talking. I was trying to tweet something you said in an ad played, and I feel really bad. But anyway, my question is, everyone touched on how the Obama administration has, in an unprecedented way, you said in a draconian way, really cracked down on whistleblowers. And my question is, why the Obama administration? Because we see a lot of these cases start somewhere else or during another administration, during the Bush administration. A lot of your clients started originally being, I guess, surveilled and unfairly treated by the government, but why is the Obama administration the one that has come forward and used the law and, like, as Tim said, a way that is incorrect here, repeatedly?
Thanks for your question. I think Obama came into office seen as being weak in the areas of national security and intelligence and wanted to kowtow to those establishments. I think he also became enamored with the secrecy that that power confers on you. Every president is against leaks, but for a constitutional scholar who should know better, you know, the conclusion is he's been worse for a free press and for whistleblowers than Richard Nixon. And that's not my conclusion. That's the conclusion of the New York Times. And that's a shameful legacy to have. I wish I could better ascertain, even though, I mean, two of these cases did, investigations started under Bush. And as a whistleblower myself in the Bush administration, it was brutal. I was put under a federal criminal leak investigation. I was referred to the state bars in which I was licensed as an attorney, and I was put on the no-fly list. But at least I was never prosecuted. It took Obama to do that, and that's unfortunate.
This would also be for Jesselyn, sorry. do you see a double standard when there's leaks from the government, I guess government-approved leaks, and the case with General Petraeus, who was out on, pled guilty to Petraeus? Do you see a double standard there?
Absolutely. Like I said, the powerful and the politically connected, General Petraeus is a great example. He leaked information classified at a far higher level than any of the Espionage Act defendants, and he received a sweetheart plea deal to a misdemeanor and a fine that was easy for him to pay, but no jail time. People like the past and current directors of the CIA, including Brennan, including Petraeus, including Panetta, all have leaked undercover identities and classified information for Hollywood movies, glorifying Zero Dark 30 and the Bin Laden raid, for book tours. And again, there's no punishment whatsoever. And these are the directors of the agency who are doing this. And meanwhile, they have the audacity to go out and make statements about how Tom Drake or John Kiriakou or Jeffrey Sterling didn't honor their oath to some kind of non-disclosure agreement. You can read leaks every single day on the front page of every daily newspaper that come from the CIA, and none of those are punished. And what John and Jeffrey and Tom Drake and Ed Snowden did, they actually did obey an oath. A higher oath, the oath they took to defend the Constitution against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
This is probably for is there a precedent, or can you talk about the more political odds of pardon for any whistleblowers or related cases?
Bush pardoned his buddy Libby, Scooter Libby, who was obviously tangled up in a leak investigation of CIA operative Valerie Plame's name. And Bush pardoned Libby. The presidential pardon power is loosey-goosey, and it's, you know, technically, you have to admit guilt, or technically, I mean, there, it's been handed off to the Justice Department Office of Pardon Attorney, but the President of the United States can basically do whatever he wants. That said, I am not hopeful that Obama will grant a pardon, but that would be a big stain on his legacy if he does not.
Can I add something to that?
Sure.
Barack Obama has pardoned fewer people.
To the mic.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes. Barack Obama has pardoned fewer people in his administration than any other president in American history. It's just a cold, hard fact. And I'm telling you as a pardon applicant, I'm not hopeful of gaining a pardon. And, you know, when you look at other former prisoners who have requested pardons, some have gone to their graves requesting pardons. And it's not just pardons, it's commutations and it's compassionate release. This is just something this administration doesn't do. There's no human sympathy, no human feeling for people. And there's certainly no belief in rehabilitation. And so, at least in my own personal case, I see the numbers. I see he's pardoned something like 8 people in the last 7 years compared to hundreds under even the Bush administration. So I guess we all hope that in his final days, where he doesn't have to face any political consequences, that maybe he will submit a pardon list that's extensive and brings him up to the levels of previous presidents.
Yeah, hi, my name is Alex, I'm with The Intercept, and I was wondering if I could ask Jesselyn or anyone else who wanted to comment on the extraordinary delays in this case, the pain of a sort of decades-long legal proceeding. Forgive me if I get the dates right, but I think it's, you know, House first raided in 2004, the indictment doesn't come till 2009, and finally we get this conviction in 2015. I mean, that's well over a decade after the fact. So is that typical, and what's the effect there?
Yes, this is actually, I mean, long delays in investigations. I mean, Tom Drake was under investigation from 2006 until he was indicted in 2010, but the investigation began in 2002. John Kiriakou was being investigated from at least 2007 before he ended up being indicted years later. And I really believe the maxim that justice delayed is justice denied. And it shows an administration willing to reach back into another presidential administration and take cases that were basically had died on the vine, like in Tom Drake's case, in John Kiriakou's case, you know, where criminal referrals had been rejected repeatedly, and to suddenly enliven those and bring full-on prosecution and do so under the Espionage Act. I mean, it's a real problem, and I think in Jeffrey's case was complicated by the fact that twice under Bush and once under Obama, the president, the administration's Justice Department subpoenaed attorney Jim Risen, and that is an extraordinary thing for the Justice Department to do, to subpoena a reporter to testify against a source. So for all those years, Jeffrey's case was further held up by the fact that the reporter source privilege, a very valid collateral issue, had to be litigated all the way up to the Supreme Court, and you know, before Jeffrey's case could proceed in full. And all these years, these conscientious employees have had this sword of Damocles dangling over their heads. Being under criminal investigation, I can tell you firsthand, leaves you both unemployed, unemployable, bankrupt, blacklisted, and broken.
Okay. Holly, I was wondering if you could talk about what initially led to the racial discrimination suit and what role you think that played in more detail in the whistleblowing, like, prosecution?
Yes, certainly.
Ultimately, Jeffrey filed discrimination because he was trained as a case officer. And when he was to get his first assignment overseas to, I believe it was Germany, his superior came to him and said, you're no longer going there. We have someone else that's going to go there. He asked why, and he said, we frankly think you'll stick out as a big black man speaking Farsi. To which Jeffrey said, A, when did you notice I was black? And B, you taught me Farsi. So that was really kind of the start of it. And then after that, the gentleman that originally was to go left the agency, and they came back to Jeffrey and said, you will now go to Germany. And he said, I secured another assignment. And they said, basically, you either go or you don't have a job. Jeffrey went over there and did not have any proper coverage to do his job, any proper supports. So he quickly came back to the U.S. and then just had further issues at the job. And so that's ultimately what led him to file the discrimination suit. And in terms of your second question, I believe it played hand in hand with what they have done to Jeffrey. They wanted to make an example of Jeffrey because he had the audacity to stand up for himself and file a discrimination suit. And it actually, the lower courts had deemed that he had more than enough information to prove that he had, in fact, been discriminated against. It only went up to the Supreme Court. And at that point, they stated that they were going to invoke state secret privilege because he could not go forward with his suit without having to talk about discrimination to or talk about classified information to prove his discrimination case. So,
I guess it would be for John Kiriakou. Can you talk about the process? You've been there going through the, try to go through the proper channels to blow the whistle on something, or in Jeff's case also, either through the CIA or the Senate Intelligence Committee. And if you, what kind of resistance you're met with and what that culture is like within these agencies?
I actually did not go through channels, and I'll tell you why. It's because my channels of leadership were the creators of the torture program. And so what do you do? In the case of torture, I worked for the CIA's Counterterrorism Center. The leadership there created the torture program, asked permission to implement the torture program, carried out the torture program, and then, when push came to shove, destroyed the evidence of the torture program. The Senate and House Intelligence Committees were both briefed on the torture program and had approved of it. So I didn't go through channels. I went directly to the press. But we know from starting with the Tom Drake case that if you do go through the proper channels, it's the kiss of death. You're going to be charged with espionage. You're going to be charged with theft of government property, which is the information that you're carrying out of the building in your head. And you're looking at dying in prison. In fact, I think the prosecution actually told Tom, take a plea and you might live to see, you might live to meet your grandchildren. But again, that's the goal. The goal is to just crush you so that you can't possibly recover through the course of your lifetime, and also to frighten other people who might be thinking of becoming whistleblowers. This is the problem, really, with national security whistleblowers. We have a Whistleblower Protection Act in this country, but national security whistleblowers are exempt from its coverage. And so you can either go through channels and risk prison, or you can go to the press and risk prison, or you can just keep your mouth shut. And the powers that be are banking that you're just going to keep your mouth shut.
This one will be for John as well. I'm wondering if you could just speak about the importance of the political moment now, especially with GOP presidential candidates openly talking about reviving torture program. And what are the problems with some of that information remaining classified?
Right, that's a good question. Never in my life have I seen so many presidential candidates promising the American people that on their first day as president, they're going to commit an impeachable act, that they're going to commit a war crime or a crime against humanity, because that's really what the torture program is. Whether we like it or not, we have a federal torture act in this country that specifically defines torture and specifically prohibits it. We are signatories to the United Nations Convention Against Torture, and indeed we were the authors of the United Nations Convention Against Torture, which also defines and specifically bans it. So they can use whatever euphemism they want, whether it's enhanced interrogation techniques or whatever. It's still torture, and torture is still illegal. I like to think, I like to hope that at least in government we've gotten ourselves to the point where we recognize that it was wrong, that it was illegal, and it was immoral, and we won't revisit it. Now, John Brennan, whom, frankly, you know, I've known for 20 years and don't trust as far as I could lift him and throw him. John Brennan at least said that there wouldn't be another torture program in the event that a Republican who supports torture is elected president. You know, the CIA has lied to us about absolutely everything they've said since 2001. So do we take his word for it? I don't know. I hope so, but I'm not really sanguine that he is telling us the truth. In any event, it's up to us to make sure that our elected officials understand that we will not tolerate another torture program. It's illegal, it's immoral, it's unethical, and frankly, it serves as the greatest recruiting tool for our enemies.
I have a follow-up to that specifically. How much of that, though, I mean, the fact that GOP candidates are openly talking about reinstating a torture program has to do with the fact the Obama administration deliberately chose not to legally prosecute anybody.
Oh, yeah.
You're the only one.
I think that's a real motivator. Look, the torturers weren't prosecuted. The people who created the torture program weren't prosecuted. The attorneys who offered up specious legal opinions justifying the torture weren't prosecuted. So, yeah, why not if there's nothing to lose? Let me add one more thing, too. In January of 1968, The Washington Post ran a front page photograph of an American soldier waterboarding a North Vietnamese prisoner. When Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara saw that photo, he ordered an investigation. The soldier was arrested, he was charged with torture, and he was convicted and imprisoned. Well, the law hasn't changed since 1968. It's the same law. So why was torture illegal in 1968 and wasn't illegal in 2002? Or in 2015? Why did it take a reiteration of a ban on torture in the form of the McCain-Feinstein Amendment to say that torture is illegal? It's always been illegal. So this talk among Republican presidential nominees just illustrates to me their utter ignorance of what the law is and what the job demands. And I think that now that the torture program is out there in the public, we need to stand up as American citizens and say we are not going to go back to those dark days.
Are any other questions?
One more.
Yes.
Okay. For Holly again, or anyone else who was involved in this decision, why now? Why is now the right time to deliver the petition? Why not sooner or later?
Norman, you might want to step in here, but we're just really trying to advocate for Jeffrey, get our voice out there, and I think once you kind of get past that 100,000 mark, it kind of makes and sets up, you know, tone that, you know, the American public and the world and country, you know, is supporting Jeffrey, and they realize that this something is wrong and trying to get the attention of the president. But like I said, please, we're not taking it down. We want the numbers to continue. So.
Hey, do we have any other questions?
Well, we have the room till 11 o'clock, so everyone's invited to stay and do one-on-one interviews. And then a few minutes after 11, we're going to go over on foot. You're welcome to accompany us or take a cab or whatever and see you over at the White House, hopefully, at around 11:30. Thank you for being here.
Sorry. Butch Hart. It's a bad car to drive.
Oh. Jeffrey and I, and being here in front of the White House, we have a stack of petitions, as you can see, that we are calling for an immediate pardon for my husband Jeffrey, who was wrongly convicted under 7 counts of the antiquated Espionage Act for being a whistleblower. Standing beside me and in support and solidarity is Jesselyn Radack and John Kiriakou and Professor West. Individuals also that have unfortunately been scrutinized and have faced this injustice. I would like to turn it over right now to Professor West to say a few words.
Yes. What a joy to come here to bear witness and to know that all the lies told about our dear brother, Jeffrey Sterling, will be repudiated. And his integrity, his honesty, his decency, his virtue will be vindicated. And we are going to bear witness to the end to ensure that those realities come into being.
I would also like to say that the petition is still going forward. So please go to rootsaction.org. To change.org and please sign. We are not going to stop. It's going to be up there indefinitely until Jeffrey is home. We are also appealing this wrongful injustice and conviction. For those of you that don't know, this has been going on since approximately 2000, which is now 16 years ago that this case has been going on. Jeffrey was also historically the first African-American CIA case officer to file discrimination suit with the CIA, which basically started all of this. It was determined that he was, in fact, discriminated against. That kind of started the ball rolling. And then they alleged that he disclosed confidential information with the reporter James Rising, who subsequently wrote a book. And that just continued their pursuit of my husband. So I'm urging all of you to please stand in solidarity with us and for all of the other people that have the courage to speak out for all of us on our behalf to report what is wrong and to protect us. Please go and sign the petition. Thank you. Thank you.
So the petition will be delivered electronically to the White House. They assured us they are really aware of this initiative. They received Holly's letter in October, and they answered to us that the appropriate officials are following this case very closely, and we will continue to raise awareness about this injustice until Jeffrey is safely back home, until all journalist sources, all whistleblowers are not prosecuted anymore under the Espionage Act. Thank you.